He's up late to give you the news you can't get anywhere else early. He fights for truth and justice and the American way. Please welcome our pal from the Paragon Trust Company, the real Tony D, Tony D'Angelo.
Tony D joins us. It's 7 after the hour, 7 o'clock, and he joins us every Tuesday to chat about a number of different things happening, not only here in the state of Connecticut, but beyond. You can follow him on Twitter, Tony D'Angelo 7. Tony, good morning.
Everybody, I'm proud to be among you.
All right, so you want to talk a little bit about the Hunter Biden whistleblower situation?
Just a moment, if I may. You know, the news came through last night that it is suspected that the Justice Department pulled the whistleblower team off the case on Hunter Biden's matter, his evasion matter. And I just want to make one thing clear. Even though I think Hunter's attorney probably got this from somebody he worked with in the government, the feds do this all the time. You know, you can be having progress with somebody and then that person just mysteriously goes away. And then another person comes and there's no rhyme. There's certainly no management reason for that. And why do the feds do it? It's because they can. They're the feds. And it's basically, and the only thing I would say is that, and a lot of what you get from the whistleblower office when you see it, it's not really doing what it needs to do. It's a lot of the analysis that goes on. You can talk about FBI analysis, you know, with the Durham thing, but a lot of the analysis that goes on at the whistleblower office is simply gaga and caca. It's terrible. And not only that, but it's secret. You can't get your hands on it, or, you know, you might be able to. But it would be nice if we're going to be reforming things, it would be really, really nice to have a reformed whistleblower that was transparent, where you can see what was happening, where you could pull FOIs easily, because it's, you know, it's just terrible the way it is. And I said a couple weeks ago we'd be kind of spinning our wheels on this. Now we're really going to be spinning our wheels in proportions that, you know, I myself had never imagined.
So we're not horrified that they pulled these people off then? I'm not mad as hell.
Well, no, you should be. You should be. But it's the kind of thing where this is not unique to the Internal Revenue Service of the United States government. This type of thing is not the first time with it. No, it goes on all the time. It's terrible, and it's a shame. And it needs to stop.
All right. Fair enough. Tony D'Angelo again with us. Switching from that, whatever happened to Semaphore?
Well, I'd like to get into that in just a moment.
Okay.
But I want to talk about the celebratory end of COVID. You know, King Governor Ned Lamont, the unaccountable of Connecticut. On May 11, 2023, he said, it's over. It's over. War is over. Why is war over? It's over because we've assessed and the vaccines have worked and the healthcare infrastructure is a whole lot better. He and his experts had a conference, and but it may not be over. You know, we might see this again, but now we're ready. And the only reason it's over is basically he ends it on the same day that Papa Joe cuts off the funding. I mean, and actually there's no mention of that in any Connecticut media. So basically the jig is up, the money's run out. And it's this whole thing that they want you to do either one of two or three things. Just forget COVID ever happened, or revel in their marvelous victory of destroying the economy, closing 1,000 restaurants, and discouraging future ones from ever opening, and making the Lamont family even richer. And then they wrecked kids. They gave low-level bureaucrats beer muscles. And I don't want people to forget that. I'm not saying hold this grudge and unforgiveness, but don't never forget that, and never forget the fact that this happened. But now to Semaphore, and just for the heck of it, the other day I pulled up the stock price of GeneDx this week. Now that's the renamed Semaphore. It's trading at about $7 a share. I thought, wow, what happened? It used to be like 30 cents. Now you might think that's pretty good, but basically, What it is that it is a bookkeeping entry, and it's called a reverse stock split on a 1 to 33. So basically what they did is they took 33 shares of Semaphore, GMD, and combined it to be one share. And they did that because the stock exchange pretty much said, look, this value is just so low. You've got to get this thing consistently over a dollar or we're going to delist you, meaning that you won't be able to trade. Nobody will know what it is. You won't get new investments. And basically, you're going under. Now, when you do all that, when you unreverse the reverse split, the value of a share of Semaphore in equivalent dollars, or rather pennies, is about 20 or 21 cents a share. Now, this is after, you know, $45 million of state money, you know, $250 a pop genomic testing, the $15 million disappearing loan that all of a sudden one day, just because of a couple of forgivenesses, went down to $6.25 million. And then the fundamental thing here, Lee Elci, is, and I was looking at this last night, we don't even know if the darn tests were good. I mean, there's a lot of issues with these tests if you read the NIH. And there was a report in 2020 where basically the Department of Health, I don't know if they meant to do this, but they said, well, we sampled 144 of tests. They didn't say who the testing companies were, cough, spit. But out of that 144, we found errors in 90. So what this whole thing is that you've got this, you know, COVID's over, that's great, we've survived and all that. We had the pump, we had the high thing, we had the public offering, and now we're dealing with the dump on the state nickel and on the state dime, and no one is saying boo about this. It's like, you know, sweep it under the rug. It could happen again. It could happen tomorrow, and I think it's terrible. I mean, and this is something again we shouldn't forget. Not in the sake of grudge, but something like this should never happen again. That's just me.
So you're telling me over 50% of the tests failed?
Yeah, 2020 report was 90 of 144. We don't know. I mean, we were told, and one person had told me, I mean, I haven't been able to put my finger on it, but this was under an EUA, emergency use authorization. But in this person's estimation, that wasn't proven, you know, to that point. It might have been at some point, but the fact of the matter is there are issues in the testing. And it's like, well, you know, what are we in for? It's like every time you think there's some rhyme or reason to this thing, you end up with even less.
Do we know what they own of this still or no? We have any idea?
I don't think there's any way of really finding that out. Yeah. I mean, it's basically because it's into a partnership. The partnership is offshore. We really don't know, and I think basically they picked the carcass out of it. So it'll be a wonder if it survives.
Right.
And of course, if it doesn't survive, I mean, the state will have to do some other bookkeeping chicanery to say, oh yeah, they paid the loan. You know, they paid the loan with the money that we gave them to create the jobs. You know, it's basically what they did.
Tony,
but you know, it leads to something else.
Yeah, well, always does.
Somebody came to me this week and said, but you know, Tony, we're not going to have any more Semaphores because the state amplified the False Claims Act. Oh, yeah, really? What is that? HB 6826, this was done in our legislature by a vote of 138-7. And you read the Tong press release from our AG, William Tong, and that it expands the definition of false claims to go right across away from healthcare providers and things like that to other state agencies. But in order to do this, as I was explaining to this person, what defined for me what a false claim is. Now, this is celebrated, you know, Connecticut's going to clean its house. Hey, how about that? And a false claim is basically you're asserting that goods or services were provided when they were not, or you're inflating, or you're double billing, or false documentation, or concealing information. That's the book rule definition of a false claim, or colluding with others. Now, here's the operative questions I told this person. is what Semaphore did a false claim. And basically, this person looked at me and said, well, maybe. I said, yeah, that's the point. Maybe. It doesn't touch what goes on in the most two critical areas of the corruption in this freaking state, which is things like Semaphore, you know, multi-part corruption, money being handed over. And then it doesn't touch the functional nonprofits. You know, it doesn't touch the advanced CTs. It doesn't touch the UConn Foundation. It doesn't touch 4CT. And these are the things that really need to be shut down. And what's amazing to me, I am a pea brain. I am an avowed pea brain. But I drafted, you know, a provision 9 that could have killed all this stuff dead. And all you had to do was add in this whole thing that was written down. Anyone using their official position or influence to secure for themselves any contract or agreement with state programs or state-associated nonprofits that benefits them financially, if they know or should know that this constitutes a conflict of interest, put it up there with the false claim. And I mean, I'm not a master draftsperson, but the only thing I'm saying is you've got, I don't know, 100 and some odd people in a room. And in what they have done, what they're really saying is something like Semaphore, Lee Elci, it never happened. It never happened. It never went on. You know, this is something that, you know, is just there, or it didn't or whatever. And it's like, you could have killed this sucker dead, and you didn't. And I am so freaking angry at that. There is nothing here that would ever stop the state from ever, 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 ever having another Semaphore. I mean, it's, you know, life goes on, la la, COVID's wonderful. Shame on all of us.
Well, you're asking them to inflict some or influx some ethics into this. That's not the right word.
Well, why not? Yeah. I mean, you had the perfect opportunity.
Of course.
You had because the perfect they don't want to do opportunity. It. And all you had to do was, like, you know, pay 10 cents worth of attention, and you didn't do it. And then you want to allude to us that, you know, everything is wonderful. Everything is ethically fixed.
Right.
I mean, what's the next Semaphore? What's the next, you know, rape of the public treasury, for crying out loud? The rape of personal information.
Right. Tony D'Angelo, it was Infused that I was thinking of, and I got that wrong. But I appreciate, as always, you on top of all of this stuff. And I want to switch till this next topic because I think this is a big deal, and it sort of flies under the radar, and it's something that I've been talking about here for a long, long time. And, you know, it goes hand in hand, I think, with the ethics and character of the people that we have in Hartford. So the unaccountability, or Ned the Unaccountable, as you call him, with the unaccountability for folks who drink and drive. Tell me what you think about this.
Well, and this is interesting. And it's like it's like so many things, as you were speaking in your most excellent monologue this morning about the law is that for what the people on the side of the Stasi, as Mark Levin would say, want it to be, you know, for them and not for us. And I asked myself a hard question. Can Ned the Unaccountable protect us from, you know, vehicle assault and drunk driving and you know, the carrying on in the legislature and things like that? Now, when he is asked, he just kind of, you know, does his what me worry, you know, this is what goes on, you know, we can handle it, it's everything is fine. But I started to study, and this is my whatever you want to call it, it's either my lot in life or having no life. I started to study in the statutes, and I actually went back to the legislative histories, which are pretty interesting, talking about what latitude does Ned the Unaccountable have in order to say, enough, I want to put a stop to this. This is a terrible situation in the state. We've got people who are supposed to be setting the example, carrying on like drunken fools, you know, vehicle assaults and things like that. But, you know, we just, you know, come by, everything's fine. And on his page, I invite everybody to read this. Read about what a civil preparedness emergency is. And it says, what does it authorize the governor to do? And, you know, his words, not mine. The governor may also take such actions that are reasonably necessary to protect the health, safety, and welfare of the people of the state, to prevent or minimize loss or destruction of property, and to minimize the effects of hostile action. Now, if you carry that to the statute, and this is the thing, Connecticut's got some great laws. They don't read them. They don't look at them, but they're great laws. And this is a very developed statute, 28.1, Definition 3 of what is an emergency. An emergency means, and this is the statute, any occasion or instance for which, in the determination of the governor or the president, doesn't involve the president, God help us all, state or federal assistance is needed to supplement state or local efforts to save lives and public property. Now, you move that down to civil preparedness, Part C. With the immediate emergency conditions which would be created by any, you know, such attack, major disaster, emergency. Well, maybe it's not an attack or a major disaster, but it is an emergency if the governor deems that to be an emergency, because the governor has the discretion to deem what an emergency is. And he can actually, and if you go to his actual declaration of COVID, the first one, March 10th of 2020, there was no great reasoning. There was no thing of I've got to call the houses in or anything like that. He just pretty much said, I'm doing it. It's done. Bang. Bye. And that's the power that the governor has. Now, he could clean house immediately, and it all comes down to, Lee Elci, what he perceives to be his definition of an emergency. Do you want to call what's happening in Hartford an emergency, or with the drunken driving, or, you know, the issues we've had with drunken legislature?
Yeah.
I think it's an emergency. I think it's a guy gets on a highway one day and doesn't come off. A working guy with a family. I mean, I think it's an emergency. That's my estimation. If he doesn't feel that way, he doesn't have to call it that. My question is, why doesn't he feel that way? I mean, you know, how out of control do we have to be?
I got to tell you this, too. I think that goes with a lot of legislators who seemed a very laissez-faire attitude towards all of this. In fact, I was watching the Capitol report this weekend, and they put an exclamation point on my point, saying that, you know, they don't think it's a big deal in some cases. Obviously, they think people dying is a big deal, but they don't think drinking or the casual drinking at the Capitol, I don't get the impression that they think that's a big deal. You're up there to write laws. You're up there to represent the people in your district. Yeah, okay, I don't drink, but I'm not a choir boy. It doesn't mean that, you know, I haven't, you know, seeing the same things that everybody else has seen. And my point is that you have to have some self-control when you're representing people in the state of Connecticut. You don't, it's not a party up there. You know, I'm sorry, but you shouldn't be drinking while you're legislating ever. And if I were the governor, I'd make that the way it is, or, you know, my way or the highway with that.
Well, and that's the fundamental thing. You know, Jim Cameron wrote an op-ed piece in the Connecticut Mirror about, you know, the legislature, and he had some very good points about how out of control the state is, but he said, you know, let the legislature act. I think the legislature has proven right now that it's incapable of acting or unwilling or just wants to continue to dance around the maypole. And I mean, now I think it goes right to the unaccountable. He's got to account for something.
Right.
And I think anybody that lets him off the hook on this, I mean, shame on you, shame on him, because what's going to be next? I mean, it's like, it's fine. No, it's not fine.
Right.
And you know what? If people want to disagree with me, and they do all the time, and that's their prerogative, and, you know, I mean, I want to be right. More so, but as far as what they think about is entirely up to them. Go back and read the text, and I did this. Public Act 75643 in 1975, and it was something, this is back when Joe Lieberman was in the State House, and they wanted to get, and this goes to the Disaster Relief Act of 1974. They wanted to get entirely away from anytime something is wrong, let us call a committee, because you may not have time to call a committee. So let us put the power in an effectively acting chief executive. And now they want to say, oh, no, none of that ever happened. I mean, basically, I've come to one conclusion. If you want to find out what's happening, you know, in the law, in a situation, it's like, you know, it's almost to the point of, I'm not saying every single person, but don't believe a legislator and don't believe corporate media. You know, kids, you got to look it up for yourself.
Tony D'Angelo, follow him on Twitter, TonyD'Angelo7. We're lucky. We get him every Tuesday. Tony, thank you, sir. I'll talk to you next week.
Thank you, pal. Thanks, everybody.
All right. We'll come right back. Bruce Flax will join us.